Thank you. I'm trying to be cool right now, but it's kind of difficult. Good evening and welcome to the first concert of my very first ever concert tour, to the incredible and unbelievable Albert Hall. It is just the greatest honor to be standing on this stage. Needless to say, tonight is an incredibly exciting evening for me. I've spent a good part of the last 40 years inside a recording studio, the last 32 of which happily composing film scores for the most part, but privately, secretly knowing that eventually I would have to leave my studio and do this. About doing this tour, I knew then that the time had come for me to emerge from my studio and put on my armor and pick up a baton and stand in front of an orchestra. And that may not sound like a big deal to most of you, but I had had some very unpleasant conducting experiences early on in my career. I'll give you an example. Here in London in 1976, 41 years ago, I was here conducting a small string section for my dear friend and great singer, Kiki D. And about after the second or third take, the first violinist raised his hand and asked if I would please stop conducting because I was distracting the orchestra. As you can imagine, it rather put me off conducting for a long time. I'd like to think that I've made some progress since then. So to that end, beg your indulgence as we here on stage, myself, this extraordinary orchestra and wonderful choir, put forth our best efforts at entertaining you tonight. I love London. It is my second home. I could think of no more glorious place in the world to begin my tour than here at the Royal Albert Hall. I had already written the main theme of the movie when we did Signs, not much of a theme really, but his hope was that we would find a way to use three notes, those three notes that is really the prime mover in the score. If you've seen the movie, you know that there's quite an important and powerful emotional pause, part of the movie, and that obviously it would be impossible to do a whole thing like that, so I had to figure out a way to keep the three notes alive, but also have it serve the emotional and even the spiritual needs of the movie, so I ended up coming up with this. So still three notes, but it's kind of pretty, and it really works in a really good way emotionally. So I think that you'll be able to hear that three note idea really clearly in this piece, the first piece we're going to do now, as we do music from three movies that M. Night Shyamalan, my good friend and director, and I worked on together. Thank you.
not ready. What are you gonna do?
Thank you.
piece. I never intended to be a film composer at all. I actually think of it as something of a happy accident, very happy, but an accident. I never really even enjoyed or paid much attention really to film music. When I was a kid, I really loved the music to the original King Kong, and lots of Elmer Bernstein scores, Ten Commandments and Magnificent Seven, To Kill a Mockingbird. But my relationship with film music really changed in 1981 when I saw what we call Raiders of the Lost Ark. That film was so exciting, the music was so exhilarating. The screenplay was by Lawrence Kasdan, who has since written The Empire Strikes Back, Return of the Jedi, Bodyguard, Star Wars The Force Awakens, and next year's Solo, A Star Wars Story, in collaboration with his son, John. He's an amazing writer and just an all-around amazing guy. Among the films he has directed are The Big Chill, Accidental Tourist, Body Heat, French Kiss, The Grand Canyon, not The Grand Canyon, it sounds like Stephen Wonder instead of Stevie Wonder. My professional relationship with Larry Kasdan is one of my most treasured partnerships, truly, and he has become one of my dearest friends. We've done 6 films together, including the one we're going to do next, during which my first son Jackson was born, called Wyatt. We're now going to do the main title and then the wedding scene from Wyatt Earp, and we will segue from that into a song which some of you may know. And tonight it's of special significance to me because the song will be sung by my daughter, Anouk.
Where are you headed, Wyatt?
No worse.
thought you went to London.
You changed your mind.
Where are you going, son?
To town. I'm going to enlist, Pa. I want to fight the Rebs with James and Birch. I'm ready.
Are you? You think your mom's ready?
I don't think she is.
Why'd you wait till I left to take off? Why? If you think it's the right thing. Virgil and James should be coming on home any day soon now. Until they do, you know your job. What was that? I didn't hear you.
The acres of corn.
You take on a job, you finish it. Any man who can't be depended on steady is worth the trouble having around.
What makes you think they're coming home soon, Tom?
Well, this war can't last forever. Besides, it's what I want to happen. You know I gotta whip you a bit.
Stranger. We met at midnight in the hang of tree. Are you coming to the tree where dead men called out for his love to flee? Strange things did happen here, no stranger would it be. We met at midnight in the hang of tree. Are you coming to the tree?
so much. I was thinking, I remember the other day, I remember a while ago, actually, it wasn't the other day, it was a while ago, that I was taking my my two sons to school when they were quite young, Jackson and Hayden, and one of the parents, who I didn't know, but I'd seen him around before, he was I think I knew he was a psychologist, and he came up to me and said, "Oh, you're the film composer, right?" And I said, "Yeah, I write music for movies." And he said, "Do you do anything?" And I didn't know how to respond. I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Well, when you go to your office, do you actually do anything?" And I guess I was insulted. I didn't know how to answer it really, but I want to do something now that does show you a little more clearly, maybe, than maybe he needed more information about what it is that I do. I was having dinner in 2005, and my phone rang, and it was my agent asking me if I was interested in composing music for Peter Jackson's King Kong. And I immediately became ill because I knew that there was going to be 3 hours of music in it. I knew that I would have 4.5 or 5 weeks to do it. And I knew that I would say yes. The most difficult scene actually if you've seen the movie, it's a moment when Kong is rampaging through New York. He comes up short and he sees Anne standing there on Fifth Avenue in front of Macy's, and it's really quite a beautiful moment, but I was running out of time and I was really beginning to panic because I kept sending Peter Jackson demos of how about this, and there was just no. Eventually, Peter said, "James, when you're done working tonight at 4 a.m, whatever it is, just improvise on the piano for a while and send it to me, and we'll see if there's something there that might be useful." I did that, and sure enough, the next day, Peter called and said, "You know what, 7:46, there's 3.5 seconds of something that I think might be really good." And sure enough, that ended up being the theme for, you have to call it a love theme, because even though it's a gigantic ape and a woman, it's purely platonic, obviously. But it is, the theme and the music had to contain all the elements of what a traditional love story would contain. But even more so, Kong knows at that point his fate is sealed. Anne knows that Kong's fate is sealed. So it's really a doomed love story. But I think I want to show you the picture first, without the music, so you can see the kind of challenges that were involved. It starts to feel like a very long 60 seconds when you're composing music for that, believe me. Right, so, it's so beautifully made that, I look at Kong. My daughter, Nuke, never cried ever in a movie until she saw King Kong, so I thought there was something kind of miraculous about that, considering that the beast was created entirely by computers. So we're going to do music from that scene now, and we're going to keep going on for just a little bit. Thanks.
Thank you.
you. I couldn't do a program of my film music without including music from romantic comedies, which I think at one point I was on record as saying romantic comedies were my least favorite kind of movie to work on, but I don't know, I was in a bad mood that day or whatever it was, but you know, they present as great a musical opportunity as anything else. And in my romantic comedy experience, I was given a great gift at the beginning, which was Pretty Woman and Julia Roberts as a movie star, courtesy of Gary Marshall, who is a lovely, wonderful man, great director, and unfortunately passed away last year. The movie was originally called 3,000, which was actually represented the amount of money that Richard Gere was going to pay Julia Roberts to spend the week with him. And I remember I had gotten really attached to that title, 3,000, and I thought, oh, a cool, austere, kind of interesting title. And then I heard they were going to change the name to Pretty Woman, and I thought, wow, that is really a horrible idea. I just think that just sounds like a real cheesy, terrible thing to do. But fortunately, wiser minds prevailed. So as it turns out, I've now composed the music for 9 Julia Roberts movies, lucky me, and most of them have been romantic comedies. I have also done other romantic comedies. One of them that I feel very close to is called, was called Dave, and that starred Kevin Kline and Sigourney Weaver. Kevin Kline played the part of a really super nice guy who happened to have the fortune or misfortune of looking like the president, and ended up standing in for the president after the president dies while he's having sex with his secretary. So we're gonna do now music from 3 romantic comedies, and we'll start with a little piano theme from Dave.
Thank you.
movie that I did with M. Night Shyamalan, and we first thought, everybody seemed to feel that we had an action movie, but eventually we all realized that it wasn't so much of an action movie as it was a love story. So I decided to write a score based on a virtuosic solo violin part to accompany Bryce Dallas Howard's really great characterization of the very courageous Ivy movie. I was incredibly privileged to have the great Hilary Hahn play the original violin parts in the score. Tonight, another of the world's great violin virtuosos has graciously agreed to join us on stage and to play the gravel road from the village. He is not only an extraordinary musician and a dear friend, he also happens to be a fellow honorary member of the Royal Academy of Music. So, ladies and gentlemen, will you please give a warm welcome to James Ennis. Thank you. these things can go funny. I'm going to tell you a little story now. Some of you may know that I had the great honor of playing keyboards with Elton John back in 1975 for a number of years. I've often asked my people, how did that happen? How did you get into the business? And that's why I call this part The Limitless Possibilities of Life. After dropping out of college in 1970, I spent a couple of years really lost in the wilderness. I had had a full piano performance scholarship at the University of Southern California, but I was really tired of practicing. There were just way too many young people that were better than me. I dropped out and ended up with a bunch of really interesting jobs like making candles, lubricating injection molding machines, stuffing cushions, and I didn't play any music for a couple of years. So then through a really unlikely and complicated set of events, which I will spare you tonight, I ended up making a very primitive solo album. I took it around with my manager at the time to various record labels, trying to get a deal, but I could not get one. But one record company executive, a guy named Gary Katz, who later went on to produce Steely Dan, heard my stuff and said, I think you're really good and interesting, but they'll never sign you here because your music is totally uncommercial. I persevered, and eventually I got a deal, but a tiny little label, and my little album just kind of disappeared. And time went on, I got a job playing keyboards with a great singer-songwriter named Melissa Manchester. We were based in New York, and I was making about $100 a week. One day, out of the blue, I got a call from my old manager in Los Angeles asking me if I was interested in auditioning for Elton John. I have to understand that Elton John, without question, was my hero at that time. It turned out that it was Gary Katz, the record company executive, that had recommended me to Elton's agent when they were looking for a keyboard player. I flew back to Los Angeles, and then I was told to go to the Hamburger Hamlet, which is a hamburger joint at the corner of Doheny and Sunset Boulevard, and look for a purple Rolls Royce. True. I pulled up behind the Rolls Royce in my beat-up orange Volkswagen. The door opened and an elegant-looking bearded man got out and asked me if I was James Howard. I said, yes, I am. He said, follow me. So we drove, I followed the Rolls Royce way up high to Hollywood Hills, and we ended up in front of a huge mansion. I was escorted into a palatial living room, and moments later, in walked 28-year-old Elton John dressed in tennis clothes. He was pretty much as shy as I was, and after a really uncomfortable half hour, he said, never forget these words, well, you got the gig if you want it. He wrote out a list of 30 songs for me to learn over the next few days and told me that rehearsals would start in a week in Amsterdam. Then he shook my hand and he walked out. And I was speechless and completely mystified as to how in the world he ever knew anything about me. I got up and I turned to leave, and then I saw them. 3 copies of my long-lost solo album that I was sure nobody ever, ever, ever in the future would listen to that somehow Elton had got a hold of. That's why I call this part The Limitless Possibilities of Life. It's all true. I'm going to now play a little piano piece that I wrote during that period of time. I don't think it was ever recorded, but I wrote it during that period of time when I dropped out into the great unknown.
Thank you.
happens to be a film composer. He also happens to be the most influential composer in the last 20 years, and his name is Hans Zimmer. Indeed. Hans and I have been friends for a long time, and there was a period of time where we were talking about working together a lot. You know, he would say, hey, what would it be like if I started something and you finished it? And I said, well, you know, it'd be something if I started and you finished it. And one day he called me up and said, hey, do you want to come and do Batman Begins with me? That was certainly an offer I couldn't refuse, and I said, sure. So we went over to London and we did Batman Begins together. Now, if you know me, you know I'm a composer who works kind of like banker's hours. You know, I start composing at 9 and I stop at about 6, and I go home and have dinner with my family and I sleep for 7 or 8 hours. My first day working with Hans, we were there until 4 in the morning. And it was pretty much that way for the next 2 months. But it worked out incredibly well, and we decided to do it again on The Dark Knight. And that time, Hans took the Joker, and I took Harvey Dent, Two-Face. And I have to say, I learned so much from Hans. I know you're in this audience somewhere. You're an incredible composer. If I could find you, I'd drag you up here, but since I can't. I learned so much from Hans. I don't know if I can, but we'll do it next tour. He reminded me, you know, aside from learning so much, he reminded me you're supposed to have fun when you're composing a film score. So thank you, Hans. I love you dearly. We're now going to do the Harvey Dent suite for the Dark Knight.
Thank you.
So, you know, we're nearing the end of the show now, and I just want to say one before I kind of return to what I was said I was going to say, which is that, you know, when I did that little animated thing today, I had this real crisis of confidence. I said, I shouldn't do that. It's really, I don't know, I felt uncomfortable. And then I realized, you know, that standing here on this stage in the Royal Albert Hall with this orchestra and this choir with all of you is just like, I mean, who thought that that was ever possible? So I just thank you for sharing this evening with me. I want to thank everybody here at the Royal Albert Hall for their professionalism, their kindness. They've been just so sweet to me. The Royal Academy of Music Symphony Orchestra, who are just obviously, as you just witnessed, are extraordinary. The Crouch End Festival Chorus, who are also extraordinary. I'm going to try and pronounce her last name because it involves clicking and some incredible sound, but my good friend and violin god, James Ennis, my daughter, Anouk, and, you know, writing for movies is really about telling other people's stories, and I feel like I've done it for so many years that I've had the incredible opportunity of telling my own story in a lot of ways. I think that, you know, if you're a composer and probably a writer of a number of different disciplines, that what you do when you write and you create is necessarily autobiographical. I don't think you can help it any other way. I can listen to scores of mine and just hear some craziness. I was going through a breakup, nervousness, whatever. When I did Wyatt Earp, for instance, it was kind of a dark story, but my first son was born. And courtesy of these musicians, that whole thing has come back to life, and I just hear the exhilaration and the joy that was originally intended in that music. And so I wish all of you such a wonderful life full of music and peace in this crazy world. We're gonna close with a piece that I am particularly fond of. It's Suite from Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them. I know that David Yates is in the audience too. David, bravo to you. And thank you for really the most extraordinary musical opportunity. Wherever you are, this is for Michael. Enjoy. Thank you.
bottom of my heart, really. And this, I have to just say, this incredible group of musicians and singers, they just really make it easy. We're gonna do a piece that goes back several decades and a half. It was The Prince of Tides, which some of you are old enough to remember in here. It was my first Oscar nomination, but it was a... you know, somebody suggested that I... That really, I mean, that was an amazing moment, believe me, to get a nomination. It was incredible, but it was really, working with Barbara Streisand was just really a great experience. She's a brilliant, you know, she got a lot of criticism because she's demanding and tough, as all great directors are. So, I mean, tough, that's the wrong word, you know, picky. So, anyway, this is the suite from The Prince of Tides, and the interesting thing about this, this is a score that I probably couldn't do anymore. I mean, you're not allowed to do anymore because it's sort of from another era. It's probably the end of a period of time when it was okay to be slightly sentimental and wear your heart on your sleeve, which is pretty much where I live, so.
Thank you. Thank you.